Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mothers of Massive Resistance, White Women and the Politics of White Supremacy by Elizabeth Gillespie McRae, narrated by Kirsten Potter. Introduction. Segregation's Constant Gardeners. When the U.S. Supreme Court handed down its 1954 Brown v. Board of Education decision, a young white mother near Wilmington, North Carolina, received the news with resolve to circumvent the ruling using nerve and plenty of hell in the personality. Mrs. Hugh Bell organized the Pender County Association for the Preservation of Segregation and spent the summer circulating a petition to continue segregated schools, no matter the consequences. By August, the association had obtained nearly 5,000 signatures, representing over one-third of the county's white population, and an association member delivered it to the governor of North Carolina in October. The next summer, Bell tried to rally newspaper editors and segregationists across the state. In a letter to the Raleigh News and Observer, Bell explained her commitment to school segregation as an attempt to protect her two little girls and to secure states' rights. She intended to put her typewriter to use for the cause. For others, she wrote, "Maybe it will take a little violence," glibly noting that it was too bad about the murder of the 14-year-old Negro boy, but wondered if this could be only a mild beginning. Included with the letter was the lengthy New Hanover County Preliminary Report, which she had helped to compile and distribute. Filled with questionable quantitative and anecdotal evidence, the report cataloged the deleterious effects of school desegregation, predicting the decline of the family, the schools, the state, and the nation. It acknowledged parental fears that their white daughters would marry someone's black sons and that academics would suffer as black students with low IQs and high sex drives diminished the education of white students. These problems would be compounded by the Negro teacher, who, subjected to subversive propaganda, sees the world in a way antagonistic to the white philosophy of life. These malignant consequences would ripple across the nation, the report predicted, as integrated schools fulfilled the wishes of communists and infiltrated the minds of America's youth with a one-world doctrine. In one way, Bell's segregationist moment fits well with the familiar story of massive resistance told in textbooks, documentaries, and scholarly works. In that story, white Southern opposition to the civil rights movement rises and coalesces in the decade after the Supreme Court's decision when segregationists insisted on separate schools. Pledging to avoid school integration at all costs, newspapermen and politicians named the movement Massive Resistance. Then, in 1956, echoing the desires of their constituents, 101 Southern members of Congress signed the Southern Manifesto, a proclamation to resist forced integration by any lawful means. To legitimize their rejection of the constitutional principle of federalism, congressmen and segregationists revitalized, for a post-World War II world, the antebellum precept of interposition, which held that state legislatures could intercede between the federal government and citizens of their individual state, nullifying federal laws that threatened their residence. About the same time, citizens' councils, made up of middle-class white professionals, mostly men, who ostensibly scorned the lowbrow Ku Klux Klan, KKK, spread across the South to circumvent desegregation specifically and racial equality generally. In the 1960s, Southern governors George Wallace, Lester Maddox, and Ross Barnett further galvanized massive resistance by standing in schoolhouse doors, by ranting racist ideologies on the campaign trail, and by calling on states to eliminate support for public education in their constitutions. Bell's prediction of violence came to fruition in the murder of four little girls in a Birmingham church, mobs hurling fists and insults at young men and women at Woolworth's counters and elementary schools, and policemen turning their hoses, dogs, and billy clubs on civil rights activists and bystanders. Massive resistance, the well-told story has reminded us, was short-lived. In the face of the grassroots activism of black Southerners and their allies, the reluctance of white moderates to abandon public schools, and the economic concerns of the South's businessmen, Bell's Pender County Organization and Citizens' Councils eventually disbanded, and the efforts of the powerful, the Wallaces and the Barnetts, faded. Helped along by the nation's outrage at the killing of young black and white activists, moderation gradually replaced massive resistance. Meanwhile, the State Department pressured the executive branch to support desegregation and black voting rights in order to augment the nation's Cold War agenda and counter damaging stories of the nation's racist violence covered by the communist press. Total defiance, the position of the hardline segregationists, gave way to token compliance, the position of most white moderates. By the mid-1960s, faced with the Black Freedom Struggle, the Civil Rights Act, the Voting Rights Act, and Baker v. Carr, massive resistance met defeat, and its advocates moved to the political margins. The South's segregationists lost, and the Southern political landscape shifted. Bell's activism, however, also points to some flaws in this familiar conceptualization of massive resistance. In the summer of 1954, petitions carrying the signatures of more than 80,000 North Carolinians spoke to a widespread sentiment among local people who did not rely on governors, senators, or political party machinery to direct their immediate and organized opposition to school integration. Bell's plea for North Carolina to reject the Supreme Court decision predated by more than a year the call for interposition made by the editor of the Richmond News-Leader, James Kilpatrick. Support for the segregated state existed among everyday people. Maintaining racial segregation was not solely or even primarily the work of elected officials. Its adherents, like Bell and her association, sustained the system with quotidian work and organizations that reached beyond the KKK and the citizens' councils. On the ground, it was often white women who shaped and sustained white supremacist politics. The anti-integration arguments that Bell and others employed had broad and deep roots across the South and the nation. They did not debut in 1954 as a reactionary response to the Supreme Court's decision. Political support for racial segregation was generations in the making, which suggests that truncating massive resistance to a decade obscures its political evolution and renders its activists reactionaries. The new Hanover document that Bell distributed drew on stories from both in and outside the South, pointing to the presence of a national network of committed segregationists. The document also spoke to the multiple locations where racial segregation had been and would have to be maintained. Dating etiquette, teacher training, public health policies, sexual customs, civic organizations, and in the stories people told. Federal legislation could hardly combat segregationist practices in places that lay far below legislative halls, judicial chambers, and voting booths, nor could a chronology of massive resistance that relied solely on federal legislation, judicial decisions, and violent uprisings capture how the daily, mundane, and local resistance to racial equality persisted. Finally, in Bell's defense of segregation were elements that addressed more than the South's legalized racial divide and formed the foundation of a broader political platform informed by the Cold War, communism, housing policies, federal aid to education, tax reform, and calls for limited government. This book is about that story, the story of grassroots resistance to racial equality undertaken by white women. They are at the center of the history of white supremacist politics in the South and nation. While they toiled outside the attention of the national media, for the most part, white women took central roles in disciplining their communities according to Jim Crow's rules and were central to massive resistance to racial equality. White segregationist women capitalized on their roles in social welfare institutions, public education, partisan politics, and popular culture to shape the Jim Crow order. From there, they provided a political education that mobilized generations and trained activists for white supremacist politics. These women guaranteed that racial segregation seeped into the nooks and crannies of public life and private matters, of congressional campaigns and PTA meetings, of cotton policy and household economies, and of textbook debates and daycare decisions. Their work shored up white supremacist politics and shaped the segregated state. White women were the mass in massive resistance. At times, their political activism connected them to a national network of white segregationists. Far from being regional retrogrades and outsiders in the nation, the South's female segregationists participated in the same eugenics movement that social workers in Southern California did. Protests against Social Security joined segregationists in Texas with anti-income tax advocates from Massachusetts. In the 1950s, coalitions opposing the United Nations welcomed Mississippi's female segregationists, who made political alliances with right-wing West Coast anti-communist organizations. When female segregationists called for limits on the Supreme Court in the aftermath of Brown, they received support from conservative organizations in Chicago and Seattle. In a Jim Crow nation, segregation's female activists imbued women's civic duties, womanhood, and motherhood with particular racist prescriptions. For many, being a good white mother or a good white woman meant teaching and enforcing racial distance in their homes and in the larger public sphere. In the 1970s, the anti-bussers of Boston echoed earlier activists for massive resistance when they ignored the persistence of structural racism, elevated individual rights, and made sacrosanct the rights of families to determine their children's public education. Decade after decade, the South's female segregationists were part of the widespread political mobilization of American women. To uncover this reconceptualized history of massive resistance, the lives of four educated, politically active women from North Carolina, Mississippi, and South Carolina form the narrative anchor of this book and offer a long trajectory on white supremacist politics. The public lives of Nell Battle Lewis, Florence Sillers Ogden, Mary Dawson Cain, and Cornelia Dabney Tucker paralleled the reign of Jim Crow segregation and were part of a broad and massive network of women across the South and the nation who now populate this story. Their prodigious correspondence exposed the work of the lesser-known and the fleeting, like Mrs. Bell, and the better-known and well-connected, like conservative activist and Barry Goldwater acolyte Phyllis Schlafly. It exposed a network of female segregationists that included old and young, college-educated and high school dropouts, career women and homemakers, urbanites, suburbanites, and rural residents. These women were married and single, childless and mothers. They were staunch Democrats, Republicans, and independents. Some were all three. Their formal and informal network stretched from the rural environs of the Black Belt South to the right-leaning West Coast city of Pasadena, from the bastion of Southern liberalism, Chapel Hill, North Carolina, to Boston's working-class Irish neighborhood, South Boston. The Jim Crow South, where Lewis, Ogden, Cain, and Tucker worked with their Southern segregationist sisters, was one expression of a larger, more diverse Jim Crow nation— a nation where garden club members and stay-at-home moms joined newspaper columnists and school teachers in reifying the color line. Nell Battle Lewis was a single woman with a caustic tongue and a Mencken-like pen who wrote for the Raleigh News and Observer from 1920 to 1956. Born to one of North Carolina's leading families, she left the South to be educated in the North and returned as a career-minded, progressive iconoclast to begin her newspaper career from the urban environs of Raleigh. A Southern liberal in the interwar period, she moved into the Cold War as one of the central architects of North Carolina's campaigns against racial equality. On the eve of her death in 1956, she celebrated knowing that resignation to the court's Brown decision had morphed into a broad resistance against desegregation. Born on a cotton plantation along the banks of the Mississippi River, Florence Sillers Ogden remained in Rosedale, Mississippi, with her Chicago-born husband on her family's land. A member of the rural Black Belt elite, Ogden filtered her politics through the lenses of the old plantation class and the modern agriculturalist. She shifted seamlessly between working with white women in the Daughters of the American Revolution, DAR, and powerful white male landowners in the Delta Council, an economic lobby for the region's cotton growers. In the 1960s, she looked to Chicago as well as Jackson to build membership for the newly formed segregationist organization, Women for Constitutional Government, WCG. All the while, from 1937 to 1982, she authored Dis and Dat, a How to Preserve White Supremacy column in Hodding Carter's Delta Democrat and later the Jackson Clarion Ledger. From the New Deal until the Reagan era, Mary Dawson Cain was owner, publisher, and columnist of Pike County, Mississippi's The Summit Sun. Located in the Piney Woods region bordering Louisiana, Cain's hometown was in timber country. Married to a gas station owner, Cain had her own career and went to the office every day to put out her weekly paper. She was also a kind of conservative everywoman, working with political activists from Massachusetts to California to defeat prohibition, end Social Security, and oppose civil rights legislation. As a conservative among conservatives and a woman among men, she first ran for governor in 1951. She kept up her newspaper and her conservative crusades until her death in 1984. In the 1920s, Cornelia Dabney Tucker was widowed with four children and left in a financially precarious position in Charleston, South Carolina. Apolitical early, in 1937, she began a national campaign to oppose Roosevelt's court packing plan and did not stop her efforts to shape the Supreme Court until her death in 1970. By World War II, she called herself the first Republican Southern Belle and spent much of her time looking north to the investors, vacationers, and businessmen who came to her hometown of Charleston to help her craft a politics that served a segregated South. She built relationships with Republican women in New England and the Midwest, and at the same time, she cultivated a long-lasting political partnership with the rabid segregationist senator from Mississippi, James Eastland. In 1938, she left the Democratic Party, worked to build a lily-white Republican Party, and then vacillated in her partisan loyalties before moving permanently into the New Right in the 1950s. Her political work pointed to early fissures in the Solid South. Broadly, the work of female segregationists occurred in four areas: social welfare policy implemented at a local level, public education, electoral politics, and popular culture. The household production of white supremacy coalesced around the efforts by white women to police the relationships and racial identities of their neighbors. To maintain the color line, they drew on evidence gathered from their work as registrars, social workers, and teachers, and provided by local knowledge, local history, and even rumor. In part, they linked the domestic and intimate matters of sex, marriage, childbirth, and child rearing to white supremacist politics. Noted Southern author Lillian Smith recalled that when her mother taught her to love God, to love our white skin, and to believe in the sanctity of both, she was performing a political act within the intimate confines of the family. Some of the lessons about segregation taught to black and white children were powerful and private, but they were not always private. In the 1920s, white women assumed new roles in the body politic that allowed them to police physical and familial ties between black and white Americans. White supremacy became bureaucratized in a new social welfare infrastructure, and white women regulated intimate matters with the legitimacy of state sanction. In doing so, this new cadre of female workers translated their gender-specific authority as white mothers into public authority as workers for the state. White women also used public education to ensure that generations of children would be schooled in white supremacist politics, just as black women understood that schools could be a place to counter the lessons of Jim Crow. White women crafted their own version of citizenship education for a Jim Crow world. As Catherine Charon's work on Septima Clark has shown, the school as an institution proved essential to the maintenance of white supremacy, and white women provided lessons on the benefits of racial segregation and the work needed to keep it going. When white women censored textbooks or movies, funded summer schools, or conducted essay contests, they upheld segregation through a broad public education that outlasted both legal segregation and its most vociferous proponents. Suffrage moved white women undeniably into electoral politics, where they could use the weight of their votes to shape the worlds in which they lived. They worked in primaries and party conventions. As partisan actors, they canvassed neighborhoods, registered folks to vote, and volunteered at the polls. Some even ran for office. Building on their local networks, electoral politics allowed segregationist women to parlay their grassroots political work into state and national policy. Using their votes and voices, they challenged national party platforms, organized the ouster of office holders who did not adhere to their segregationist vision, and mobilized their constituents to rally against domestic and foreign policies that they believed could erode the economic, political, and cultural power of Southern whites. They built political platforms that translated political support for white supremacy into broader debates on national sovereignty, genocide, and the fate of developing nations. In the process, they boiled down communism, the rise of the United Nations, and decolonization into the substance of daily life, and then offered instruction in how to combat those forces by watching out for what their children learned, whom they married, and even how they trick-or-treated. White supremacist politics was also produced at the level of culture, where the stories white women told reinforced the Jim Crow order. White women perpetuated customary segregation through a broader creation of a popular culture that constructed and celebrated white ethnicity as superior and separate from black ethnicity, and that reified black stereotypes. Again and again, they employed their culture talk to remind Southern whites of the benefits and privileges of white society. They also offered public commentary on the appropriate place of black people in American society, celebrating the black vernacular while diminishing black accomplishments in politics, high culture, and intellectual endeavors. If black Southerners were not named as often in the other areas of the production of white supremacy, they occupied central roles in white supremacist popular culture as mammies, field workers, happy-go-lucky men and women, and manual laborers. Despite white segregationist women's ubiquitous political work, scholars of massive resistance and Southern segregation have rarely confronted them. Beyond New Orleans's cheerleaders or Little Rock's Mothers League, the white Southern women who have more often been studied were supporters of the civil rights movement. The politics of Virginia Durr, Anne Braden, white student nonviolent coordinating committee workers, and Little Rock's Women's Emergency Committee, for example, have garnered scholarly attention. The women who censored public school textbooks, raised money for the Civil War Centennial, encouraged their children to participate in essay contests, and formed or joined segregationist organizations have, until recently, remained on the outskirts of the story. The reasons for this are twofold. In part, the scholarship has adopted a more top-down examination of massive resistance that focused on laws, congressmen, state legislators, and violent episodes covered by a national media. Recent studies of Jim Crow segregation, however, have taken a more local view and examined how white supremacist politics and Jim Crow laws manifested themselves in communities as diverse as Miami, Florida, rural Mississippi, and northern Virginia, but white women have often remained bit players. Frequently, when white segregationist women have entered the historical narrative, their politics have been explained as either a result of an inherent racism or of their capitulation to patriarchal power that defined their lives, hiding their political independence. In contrast, conservative women outside the South have had their gender-based, class-based, and culturally derived aspects of their politics plumbed in order to explain how they contributed to the rise of anti-radicalism, anti-communism, and the New Right. Their racial politics, a politics often very much akin to that of their Southern sisters, however, has been treated as an aberration or a side note of a more legitimate political platform. As a result, the term segregationist, often freighted with a host of rural, retrograde, demagogic, and masculine meanings, has been reserved mostly for white Southerners, disguising both the sophistication and breadth of white Southern women's political work, and by consequence, the connections they cultivated with white supremacists nationwide. It often has also spared white conservative women the label of white supremacist. These scholarly gaps have disguised our ability to see white segregationist women's systematic and nationwide support for racial inequality and the dogged persistence of white supremacist politics, policies, and cultural practices in the decades before and after the civil rights movement. Focusing on segregationist women as grassroots activists in social welfare policy, public education, partisan politics, and popular culture reframes the story of massive resistance in several ways. First, white women's work exposes massive support for racial segregation that began long before Brown and stretches past its legislative dismantling in the 1960s. No longer limited to the years between Brown and the Voting Rights Act, massive resistance looks less like an agenda of reactionaries and more like a long-lived, sophisticated political program. Rooted in the South, massive support for various Jim Crow systems never stays put, but sends out its activists and its ideas to already active hosts across the nation. The grassroots organizing of white segregationist women becomes part and parcel of the 20th century political mobilization of women, linking massive resistance to political movements beyond the South's geographic boundaries. In the era of women's rising political activism, the longer movement of massive resistance was, for many women, their entrance into public politics and connected some of the South's leading female segregationists to post-war conservative activists. Instead of a defined moment or movement, massive resistance emerges as a kind of overarching defense of a white supremacist regime regularly reproducing support for racial segregation. It is a program that could be national in its reach, but local in its practice and prosaic in its work. By looking at white segregationist women over half a century, this story exposes the endurance and shape-shifting capabilities of white resistance. As the story is reframed, three narrative threads bind it together. At the biographical level, the book traces the political trajectory of four very different white women who worked for a Jim Crow order. Second, the book examines the symbiotic relationship between legal and customary segregation through the work white women did in social welfare, education, electoral politics, and culture. They knew that daily work on multiple levels was needed to sustain racial segregation and to shape resistance to racial equality. A third theme charts the political diversity and various political alliances that segregationist women cultivated. These networks contributed to the rise of early opposition to the New Deal state and later support for the New Right, its far right wing, and national partisan realignments. These stories encourage us, at a minimum, to reconsider and perhaps cast aside several common practices. Separating the limits of the civil rights movement from the persistent grassroots and often female-led organizing for white supremacy, segregating Southern segregationist women from national segregationist conservatives, and sparing nationally prominent conservatives the label of segregationists. They also suggest that when we focus too much on national legislative victories over legal segregation, we miss the endurance of white supremacist politics and practices in local institutions, in local communities. The political languages white segregationist women employed, in particular their experimentation with a colorblind conservatism in the rural and urban South, means that the Sun Belt suburbs were not the only location for the germination of a new politics that disguised policies supporting racial inequality behind the language of property rights, law and order, good motherhood, and constitutional intent. It also exposes how Jim Crow segregation remade itself decade after decade, courted a variety of political allies, and attracted diverse activists and followers. For too long, focusing on a narrow definition of massive resistance has left the nation ill-equipped to recognize the power of its grassroots persistence. Moving from the 1920s into the 1970s, the book charts the long era of massive support for racial segregation and the white women who served as its crucial workforce. The chapters are organized around real or perceived threats to racial segregation as envisioned by its female advocates. When white Southern women entered the polity, many did so with a pledge to uphold legal segregation. And for generations, female grassroots activists sustained and reproduced segregation in their communities. Their constant work was so interwoven into daily life that it appeared unremarkable. As they worked, some invoked and shaped a particular brand of middle-class motherhood that married gender roles and devotion to racial segregation to a political platform of family autonomy and parental rights, a kind of white supremacist maternalism. Others offered up a citizenship education reliant on racial separation that met, they believed, the nation's needs. Still others told stories that celebrated a Jim Crow order. Throughout the decades, they operated under a constant fear of threats to white supremacist politics and its accompanying Jim Crow system. Part 1, told in four chapters, examines the interwar period, where the work of white segregationist women was shaped by more discrete, local, or state-level threats. While they worked to sustain segregation, the reign of the Jim Crow order in the American South seemed relatively secure. The most significant threat to the system of segregation, white women believed, was the apathy of their white neighbors, who failed to realize the constant work needed to sustain it. The most dedicated female segregationists feared that white people would be fooled into believing that the all-white primary, the proliferation of segregation laws, stricter prohibitions on interracial marriage, the reluctance of the president or Congress to oppose lynching, the whitening of the Republican Party, and the decisions of the Supreme Court would be enough to secure segregation. Their white neighbors might believe the stories they were told, that segregation was natural, and that black Southerners were satisfied. With white apathy constituting the most important threat to the system of racial segregation, the first four chapters uncover the stories of how female segregationists used social welfare institutions, public education, electoral politics, and popular culture to reinforce the Jim Crow order. Each chapter examines the work of segregationists related to one of these institutions in particular locations. Chapter 1 looks at the domestic production of white supremacy in Rockbridge and Amherst counties in western Virginia, where white female registrars, public welfare officers, and social work students did the daily work of cataloging racial identity according to Virginia's new racial integrity law. Chapter 2 begins in Athens, Georgia, and explores how debates on curriculum, textbooks, and teacher training shaped racial segregation. Chapter 3 examines the partisan political organizing of three women in black majority areas, in Mississippi's Delta and Piney Woods regions, and in the South Carolina Low Country, white women, Florence Sillers Ogden, Mary Dawson Cain, and Cornelia Dabney Tucker weighed in on local and state partisan politics in order to mobilize women and men to uphold segregation through their political parties. Chapter 4 explores the cultural production of white supremacy through the stories, fiction and nonfiction, that the liberal white supremacist Nell Battle Lewis told in the Raleigh News and Observer and other public forums. World War II challenged their work on all levels by introducing discernible region-wide, national, and even international threats to their system. With World War II, the work of Southern segregationist women fundamentally shifted, and the war served as a dividing line between massive support for racial segregation and massive white resistance, and between the specific communities featured in Part 1 and broader regional and national concerns that frame Part 2. The post-war period led to regional political discussions and rich opportunities for exchange with segregationists across the South and nation. As the South's female segregationists grappled with regional, national, and international calls for a loosening, if not an eradication, of the Jim Crow order, their political conversations coalesced around common threats, even if the intensity of alarm differed from the Black Belt to the Upper South. From World War II on, the South's female segregationists tried to invigorate support for the system by praising racial segregation, but also by cultivating various critiques of political institutions seen as antithetical to both the South's system of segregation and to conservative political ideology in general. Segregation's activists still believed that their white neighbors were too complacent or too moderate in their commitment to racial segregation. But this apathy was accompanied by growing concern that the system was weakening under an onslaught of new threats: the growing welfare state, expansion of the electorate, competing historical narratives, vigilante violence, black out-migration, and the internationalism of the United Nations, UN, and shifting priorities of state and federal governments. The threats to the system turned former allies in segregationist politics into enemies. Demographic shifts had escalated a Southern diaspora that intensified during the war. Rising numbers of Southern and Northern members of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, NAACP, black men in military uniforms, black women moving from domestic service to the industrial working class, and black community organizers who challenged white sexual violence alarmed segregation's white activists and led to a new political calculus in the Democratic Party. The mobilization of African Americans forced the federal government to uphold non-discriminatory hiring policies in war industries through the creation of the Fair Employment Practices Commission, FEPC, at the same time that NAACP lawyers challenged the South's restrictive voting system. Labor policies and the court's decision in Smith v. Allwright further alarmed many Southern whites, who feared that the federal government was no longer on their side. Domestically, Eleanor and Franklin D. Roosevelt and the Democratic Party that they led, white women felt, imperiled racial segregation. Faced with such seismic national shifts, white complacency remained a serious but no longer the most significant or singular threat. Part 2 of this book examines how the South's female segregationists harnessed their work in social welfare, education, electoral politics, and cultural production to combat what they understood as diverse post-war threats to white supremacist politics: a faltering Democratic Party, an invasive United Nations, an interventionist Supreme Court, and eventually a widespread mobilization of black Southerners. Chapter 5 examines how during World War II, segregationist women focused their political efforts on the federal betrayal of white supremacist politics rather than black organizing. They began a long campaign against the executive branch and the Democratic Party, advertising the failure of partisan politics and the men who ran it. They cataloged the sins of Democrats, Southern and nationwide. They cultivated support for segregation by building distrust in the Democratic Party. World War II constitutes the moment when the Democratic Party existed as both the last hope and the next threat to the white South. Segregationist women encouraged the election of hardline segregationists and experimentation with partisan dissent, contributing to the rise of the Dixiecrats, the demonization of Henry Wallace, and the defeat of moderate senators in 1950 and 1952. International threats to white supremacy proliferated with the advent of the Cold War and are the subject of Chapter 6. During the height of the Cold War, segregationist women publicized the threats that international institutions and their political allies posed to racial segregation and to national sovereignty. Focusing on the United Nations and the anti-communist crusade, white Southern segregationist women found the opportunity to construct black activism as the result of outside agitation and infiltration, not homegrown organic political organizing. The reactions of white segregationist women to a new conversation on human rights led them, in the spring of 1954, to support the Bricker Amendment, a proposed constitutional amendment requiring state legislatures, not the Senate, to approve international treaties. Those fearful of the erosion of states' rights and an erosion of national sovereignty joined those fearful of the decline of racial segregation to argue that the people best situated to protect the nation from internationalists and integrationists were found in state, not federal office. Couching the UN as a threat to national security, states' rights, and family autonomy, these women drew parallels between attacks on Southern-style white supremacy and a UN-inspired world where white-ruled nations, such as the United States, were bent under the weight of the developing, left-leaning, non-white world. The anti-communist crusade that grew out of this Cold War configuration gave white Southern women the chance to connect their local politics of white supremacy to a larger conservative political movement, imbuing their daily work for segregation with national as well as international importance. Chapter 7 begins with the 1954 Brown decision and ends with the Southern Manifesto in 1956. Long able to influence public schools, their curriculum, and the children who attended them, white women now faced a direct threat to what they understood to be their private, public, and political authority, and their versions of family life and citizenship education. In the wake of Brown, they made the family the center of political life and political ideology, with parental authority threatened by a Leviathan federal government. They offered a nascent version of racialized family values, viewing schools as an extension of their home and a place where they wielded particular authority. Many white segregationist women claimed that because school integration eroded their ability to secure the benefits of white supremacy for their children, it compromised their ability to be good mothers. This political language minimized racial identity and replaced it with a particular gender identity, prioritizing motherhood while burying how whiteness shaped their understanding of it. Brown destroyed the fiction so central to racial segregation's reign that black Southerners were content with segregation, were incited only by outsiders, and were politically malleable. It also put black children at the forefront of the conversation, forcing white segregationist women to forego a maternalistic language directed at black families in their communities. In the years after Brown, white women were devoted to making white youth political activists and future purveyors of white supremacy, even as the legal support for segregation diminished. Chapter 8 examines the continued efforts for racial segregation after the forced federal integration of Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas. Amid the cacophony of racist rants, many white segregationists focused on training white youth to sustain racial segregation and gradually amplified their colorblind political rhetoric. While moderate voices directed the implementation of integration, Southern segregationist women continued to work in various ways and with various political constituencies to secure resistance to racial equality and meaningful integration. If absolute segregation was the mark of victory for supporters of massive resistance, then these years could be seen as the denouement of a movement. But even as the outward expressions of the Jim Crow South faded, the essay contests, the colorblind political language, curriculum debates, and youth programs remained, as did those who were raised to follow that vision. Some white conservative segregationists still worked for an updated version of white over black, but they also moved into the emerging new right, and some deeper into the far right, where they constructed a new political home. Employing a politicized formulation of motherhood, white segregationists across the ideological spectrum practiced a politics that emphasized performing whiteness as synonymous with good womanhood, cultivating a politics that minimized their racial identity and privileged their identity as parents and mothers to continue to sustain various degrees of racial segregation in practice, if not in law. The end of de jure segregation in no way meant the end of de facto. The lessons that arose from decades of work had taught them that. After nearly two decades of resistance to school integration, courts across the country demanded its implementation and supported busing and school redistricting as a means to accomplish it. The last chapter moves to the urban North and explores the political similarities and ties between the most committed Southern segregationists and those white women who protested busing in the 1970s. Most Americans, including white women and men across the nation who had supported Brown, resisted this new government intrusion into their parental authority, their property values, and their vision of school choice. As Mississippi's Florence Sillers Ogden had predicted, when racial integration came on a yellow school bus and threatened to reorder the daily lives of northern and western urban white women, these women reacted much like the South's segregationists. Women's organizations in Boston and Detroit looked south for models of resistance. They were also segregationists, working for various iterations of racial separation in their public schools. Boston's Louise Day Hicks and her supporters echoed the cheerleaders of New Orleans's Ninth Ward, the women of working-class neighborhoods in Nashville, and the mothers in Little Rock. Across the nation, law made busing a reality, while white women's opposition on the ground eroded the power of its implementation. The terms segregationist and conservative fill this story and deserve some definition. All the women I write about are segregationists, at least some of the time. They are not all conservatives, and certainly they are not all conservatives all of the time. Segregationist refers to people, predominantly white Southern women in this book, but also white women in Boston, Pasadena, Chicago, and Detroit, who work to maintain a system that separates white and black Americans in public life, public institutions, popular culture, and customary practices. Segregationists drew on a democratic politics that upheld white supremacy in various forms, that denied black Americans equal opportunity, and that invoked constructions of race to order society. Segregationist defines people who adhere to policies and politics that further that agenda. Jim Crow's advocates did not look the same all the time. Place and time shaped the particular contours of their segregationist politics. For decades, a segregationist could be a progressive, a liberal, a New Dealer, a conservative, a member of the old or new right, or a moderate, a hardliner, a Democrat, a Republican, or an independent. Unmooring the definition of segregationist from a specific region and time, and instead linking the definition to political action and rhetoric, I hope will be an important contribution of this book. If this history broadens the use of the term segregationist, it also reminds us that we need not homogenize American conservatism to recognize that the white supremacist politics of Southern segregationist women was a variant of grassroots conservative politics that operated nationwide and among some acolytes for the new right. Conservative describes a larger political platform and a group of activists who supported policies that changed over time. In the interwar period, conservatives railed against the income tax, the New Deal and New Deal programs, unless they were Delta planters, internationalism, immigration, and dilution of an American identity. After World War II, conservative women crusaded against radicalism and communism and the United Nations. Many supported an anemic federal budget, restricted voting rights, state, not federal, control of political and civil rights, sacrosanct property rights, and states' rights. In terms of public education, conservative women campaigned against the influence of John Dewey's progressive pedagogy, rejected multiculturalism in the classroom, opposed the creation of a federal Department of Education, and remained wed to a curriculum centered on American exceptionalism. They insisted that public schools were an extension of their homes and should reflect their values exclusively, upholding parental authority and patriotism. For the chronological scope of this book, conservatives occupied wings of both the Democratic and Republican parties, although they began a slow departure from the Democratic Party during World War II. Many conservatives also supported white supremacist politics and fought for some version of a racial hierarchy, even if they attributed their support to a belief in states' rights, a dedication to anti-communism, or an opposition to anti-colonialism. For the most part, these various iterations of conservatism did not embrace the Christian fundamentalism that came with the maturation of the new right. However, debates over prayer in schools and sex education, in which some segregationists and conservatives participated, suggested that the role of religion in public life would become an important part of the new right's agenda. Resembling the multidimensional and dynamic nature of the Jim Crow order, conservatism drew its meaning as much from the particular concerns of a specific place and time as it did from ideology. Segregationists lived across the nation. They talked to each other, exchanged political strategies, and built a local and a national politics for a post-war world. They worked consistently to circumvent the larger politics of racial equality. The Southern diaspora that defined much of the 20th century and that escalated in World War II included the migration of white Southerners raised and schooled in the politics of Jim Crow. White supremacist politics were not simply Southern politics that arrived on the backs of Southern migrants, however. They were of the nation and were not practiced solely by those on the far right. Mainstream conservatives could espouse white supremacist ideas, but still believe that a democratic government was the way to ensure white over black. In many ways, the language we have used, conservatives for some, segregationists for others, has functioned to mask a national commitment to different configurations of a Jim Crow nation. This has homogenized segregationists and systems of segregation, left them in the South, and cordoned them off in the civil rights era. This intellectual segregation has made it harder to understand how white supremacist politics has replenished itself, bearing fruit in community after community long after the nation's professed commitment to equality. As Lewis, Cain, Ogden, Tucker, and their networks teach us, white supremacist politics were both of the South and of the nation. These national networks and connections persisted and strengthened over the 20th century, but they did not erase some real differences between a region and a nation. Cain, Ogden, Tucker, and Lewis identified as Southern, acknowledged specific circumstances that they deemed Southern, and worked on a political landscape in which the construction of white womanhood served multiple purposes. The South's female segregationists operated simultaneously as part of the national political fabric and in a particular Southern political context, crafted out of particular historical circumstances and stories. In the midst of the Jim Crow era, Ralph Ellison wrote, "Southern whites cannot walk, talk, sing, conceive of laws or justice, think of sex, love, the family, or freedom without responding to the presence of Negroes." Southern white women lived where a Southern legal code made hundreds of claims on the lives of black and white, where the political system disenfranchised black and white opposition, and where an intellectual culture erased powerful stories of segregation's implementation. These conditions bolstered their activism and shaped the political strategies and rhetoric that they employed. In sustaining and shaping their Jim Crow system, they often spoke in a language of Southern history to Southern audiences, but not always. Long before the federal government crafted its opposition to legal discrimination, and long after it announced its victory over legal segregation, white women helped to sustain segregation at a local level. Disappointed by the integration of schools and the expansion of voting rights, among other policies, they did not quit. With them at the center, massive resistance is no longer solely about maintaining lily-white schools. Rather, it is about sustaining white supremacist politics through a system, however modified, of racial segregation. Responding to local conditions and opportunities, a diverse group of segregationists who differed in terms of dedication, singleness of purpose, partisan allegiance, and strategies sustained the Jim Crow order. Focusing only on the hardline segregationists and not those who spoke in a colorblind language or those who found fertile ground outside of the far right makes us miss the widespread commitment to racial segregation and the various ways it continued. Decade after decade, even in the face of apparent defeat, white women remade the Jim Crow order, in part by training new generations of activists and adherents. Their history taught them that white supremacist politics could meet changing political winds to find diverse political allies and court support across the political spectrum. Their work remained important and often beyond federal purview. Their experience told them that white supremacist politics enacted on a local level, in school board decisions, in teacher training, in bureaucratic categorizations, in public welfare policies, and in historical narratives, would prove more difficult to uproot and eradicate than national or even state-level policies. Massive resistance in the hands of white women also exposes the limits of the iconography the nation has preserved about segregation. A lynched boy, white and colored water fountain signs, Rosa Parks sitting on a bus, and George Wallace standing in the schoolhouse door. Without diminishing the profound importance of these events, these images often elide the fact that racial segregation affected people's lives in vastly different ways. White supremacist women recreated the signs of racial segregation generation after generation, but they often did not take center stage in the media drama that played out on the nation's televisions. These literal signs of segregation, so intrinsic to the story of civil rights and American freedom, do play a powerful role in the history told about the civil rights movement, in part because they were removed, offering up a story of redemption. But the other markers of a segregated nation stubbornly remained, weeds in our democratic garden. The history of the civil rights movement and the nation must expand to include the stories of everyday opposition, the white women who created a Jim Crow history in the nation's textbooks, the social workers who participated in racial categorization, limiting the opportunities for individuals for most of the 20th century, the students who benefited from a college scholarship earned because of a first-rate essay on maintaining racial segregation, and a mother walking a kindergartner to school that is evidence of de jure, not de facto, integration. In the end, the history of massive resistance that emerges out of six decades of white women's activism looks different in terms of chronology, duration, geographic boundaries, and political purpose. Working largely outside the realm of vigilante violence and outside the offices where Jim Crow's legislation was written, white women, nevertheless, sustained and shaped the nation's racial caste system at the community level. From their homes, newspapers, civic organizations, and social welfare offices, they made sure that their white neighbors knew that daily vigilance was the cost of a white supremacist political order. They participated first in massive support for racial segregation, and later, when it was threatened, massive resistance. White women were and remained segregation's constant gardeners. Part 1. Massive Support for Racial Segregation, 1920 to 1941. 1. The Color Line in Virginia. The homegrown production of white supremacy. In 1924, a 28-year-old, single white schoolteacher and local registrar, Margaret Aileen Goodman, ran into trouble when she tried to register Mr. William Clark of Rockbridge County, Virginia, under the rules of the state's new Racial Integrity Act, RIA. According to the law, individuals seeking marriage or those born after 1912 had to certify their racial identity with local officials. The law did not change the definition of black, which had moved in 1912 from one-quarter black blood to 1/16th black blood, but it did change the criteria for whiteness, not one drop of non-white blood. Except for those select few Virginians who celebrated their connection to Pocahontas, any other Indian ancestry translated into a black identity. Ostensibly, this hard dichotomy reified the color line by continuing the ban on interracial marriages and preventing the children of those marriages from shifting racial identities and passing as white. Clark did not claim Pocahontas as an ancestor, but he was part of a community of people who had been pejoratively called free issue, issues, or little people, names that indicated an indeterminate racial identity and a colored but free past. The RIA eliminated the recognition of individuals with black, white, and Indian ancestors, and Goodman had to classify her neighbors as either white or black. When Clark, whose family had been classified as alternately mulatto and white in earlier census records, met Goodman, she told him that his family was not Indian, they were not white, they were black. Clark resisted the categorization, and she reported his insubordination to Walter Plecker, her state supervisor, head of the Bureau of Vital Statistics, and one of the architects of the RIA. Goodman's confrontation with Clark pushed her into a maelstrom of local history, political realities, and evolving state policies. Goodman had grown up just down the mountain from the Irish Creek community, home of Clark and a number of families whose racial identities were fluid. Irish Creek lay just below the ridgeline that formed the border between the counties of Amherst and Rockbridge. On each slope were communities whose history reached back to the 1750s, when three white traders settled in the Blue Ridge Mountains and married Indian and black, perhaps enslaved, women. Their progeny lived in scattered communities, Bear Mountain and Peddler Creek in Amherst County and Irish Creek in Rockbridge County, that drew on a free black, white, slave, Cherokee, and Siouan past. 19th-century census records confirmed that families with the surnames Clark, Branham, Sorrels, Johns, and Red Cross, among others, had traveled between Indian, mulatto, white, and black categories. The RIA, however, gave no credence to complex pasts and complicated family trees. Thus, Goodman found herself at the intersection of her community's particular racial practices, the Clark's interracial past, and Virginia's expanding state bureaucracy. Goodman reached this crossroads as a child of the Jim Crow South. She was born in 1896, the same year that the Supreme Court decided the landmark case Plessy versus Ferguson, which upheld state racial segregation laws for public facilities, establishing the doctrine of separate but equal. She had come of age when Virginia had passed segregation laws for trains, schools, restaurants, and even prison cafeterias. Each fall, she readied her classroom to teach her allegedly all-white students in an all-white school. In 1920, Goodman and other women cast their first votes, and Virginia's most active period of segregation legislation commenced. When Virginia passed the RIA, it hardened racial lines and overturned more than a century of racial categorizations based on the racial identity of a single great-grandparent or grandparent. When Goodman faced Clark, she had to take into account local history and practices or loyalty to the Jim Crow state. She chose the state. In writing her letter to Plecker, Goodman invited state intervention and performed vital work for racial segregation. The letter acknowledged the power of a progressive era bureaucracy to create an American racial state and Virginia's requirement that its workers maintain the color line. Why Goodman participated in such an endeavor remained unclear. The correspondence about the Clarks failed to tell whether Goodman's act arose from a deep devotion to white supremacist ideology, an inclination for bureaucratic officiousness, or a tendency to follow authority figures. But her 1924 letter, as well as one 19 years later, noting that the Clarks' continued resistance to a classification of colored or mulatto, pointed to her lengthy commitment to shoring up a biracial world. For nearly two decades, Goodman did not defy Dixie's color line. Goodman's embrace of racial standardization put her in the company of other white women, who as new bureaucrats embarked on the sorting out of the American population according to race, ethnicity, delinquency, and mental fitness. Goodman joined women like Mildred Covert, whose fieldwork imposed racial classifications and criminality on California's non-white youth, as well as marriage reformers from Arizona to Georgia, who turned licensing registrars into the gatekeepers of white supremacy. Goodman's letters also pointed to the patriarchal relationships replicated by the state, whereby women on the ground implemented policies crafted by male officials, earning professional accolades, community authority, and some income. For Goodman and others, new state authority, born of the progressive era, had created zones of racial work. At the same time, it created economic opportunities for many white middle-class women. Women did more than work for the state. In the quest for racial purity, white women constituted both the subjects of racial integrity and its labor force. Women's bodies were the landscape on which the policing of racial intermixing often took place. If protected from interracial liaison, contemporary race scientists argued, white women would purify and invigorate the nation. If white women sought out sexual liaisons with non-white men, however, they could also serve as potential transgressors, ruining racial purity and, by consequence, enervating the nation. Beyond their reproductive capacity to strengthen or weaken the nation, eugenicists argued that women carried in their very genetic makeup the power to recognize race mixing. They were vital to the enforcement of racial purity. The fact that women often had the most access to and knowledge of the places where this racial classification would occur, the bedroom, the birthing room, and the classroom, enhanced their alleged genetic proclivity for detecting mixed-race individuals. The midwife had to certify race on birth certificates. Jim Crow state policy instructed the white school teacher to report to the school superintendent's office children she suspected of mixed-race heritage. The social worker recorded the racial identities of the families with whom she worked, deciding race based on a host of behavioral and hereditary observations, often mixed with a dose of local gossip. The local registrar had to turn in marriage licenses to each state's Bureau of Vital Statistics. The RIA and accompanying eugenic legislation nationwide created public policies that required enforcement by those with familiar, female faces. These jobs fell mostly to women. In the 1920s, between 80% and 90% of elementary school teachers were women. At the time Virginia's RIA became law, there were 6,000 registered midwives and only 1,500 physicians in the state. And women, like Goodman, constituted a significant percentage of the local registrars, public welfare superintendents, and nurses. These statistics signified that white, college-educated women would have to participate in the actual cartography of race. With access to local knowledge and to institutions central to the sorting out of race, women designated racial lines, labeled families, and drew boundaries around black and white in their communities. In doing so, white women made decisions that would affect families for the rest of the century. The 1924 correspondence between Plecker and Goodman testified to the collusion and cross-pollination between progressive-era state-building and white supremacist politics. From New York's Eugenics Record Office and New Jersey's Vineland Institute to California's Department of Research and Virginia's flagship university, biologists, social scientists, educators, and criminologists in the 1920s offered new theories on race, disease, intelligence, human development, and delinquency that had coalesced into national discussions on citizenship and race betterment. Popular literature by Madison Grant, Lothrop Stoddard, and others bolstered these research endeavors and made available to the masses concerns over race mixing and its alleged role in the hereditary decline of Americans, as well as an emergent discourse on race and criminality. Goodman's work in Policing the Color Line exemplified the bestowing of the authority of scientific and pseudo-scientific expertise on white women in local communities. Through her work as registrar, Goodman joined a legion of white women who used the new progressive state to give shape to racial segregation on the ground, translating legislation into local practice. Involved in regulating marriage, they worked in such routine and largely invisible ways that the state came to be an expected participant in the most intimate and personal of matters, the making of families. White segregationist women had assumed crucial roles in the domestic production of a white supremacist state. But in the case of these Blue Ridge Mountain communities, local conditions complicated the work of school teachers, midwives, and registrars who were charged with preventing passing. On the
surface. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.